Hey guys, how's it going? In this video, I want to give you a 1 year update on a few things that we planted. So about this time last year, we got some gorgeous stuff in the ground, and I just want to show you what it looks like after almost a full season of growth, starting with this lemon jade sedum. So I looked it up and we planted this on October the 4th last year. There are 5 plants in this little spot and we've enjoyed them so much. They're such a bright spot because they bloom yellow rather than kind of your traditional pink. A lot of the sedums that we put in they're beautiful, beautiful pink blooms, but it's nice to have something a little bit different. And I think they contrast really beautifully with the other colors of foliage and flowers we have in this spot. So real quick, I've got some Morden blush roses right there, which I allowed to set hips. So they'll be getting their bright orange hips here. I mean, they're already starting and that looks really pretty up against the yellow. Meteor shower verbena, a blue spruce, and then a prairie winds panicum right here. And I'm just enjoying this blend of plants so much. So when I put these in the ground, they were already about at their max height. They grow about 16 to 18 inches tall. So this is pretty much what I can expect them to do in terms of height, but they do stool out. So they grow about 2 feet, maybe a little bit more wide. And they've already done a little bit of growing that way. You can tell that they've already filled in quite a bit since last year, and I expect them to be even more thick next year. They like really dry, kind of poor conditions, and I didn't really know, putting them right next to our grass, how they would do. I didn't know if maybe it would be too much water because we have to irrigate our grass, like crazy here in Eastern Oregon because it's so dry and hot. But they seem to be okay. I only have one drip tube running through kind of the center of all the sedums rather than making sure there was an individual emitter by each root ball. Usually you can tell if they have too much water or too much fertilizer for that matter if they start to flop from the center. So if you have sedums doing that, that's probably one of the 2 reasons why. They don't want to be fertilized ever and they don't want too much water. So lemon jade is a zone 3 through 9. We live in a zone 5, so you can tell how they did through one winter. I like to keep mine up through the winter. I don't cut them back until spring because these are so beautiful through the winter. Like, I love the way they look with frost on them or a little bit of snow. And I think it provides a little bit of forage for wildlife. So that makes me feel good to leave some things up like that. They have very strong stems so they can withstand quite a bit of weight. And you know what? There are honeybees and pollinators just all over on it. And that's one thing about sedums. If you want to attract pollinators, put these in because they just absolutely love them. And I've noticed some butterflies on them as well. So these sedums are great planted in a drift just like this. You can do them kind of as your border edging like this. You could even plant one layer down if you wanted to. If you wanted to pop some annuals, if you had space, you can do that and kind of graduate one kind of more height down, like to some kind of ground cover, which eventually we do plan on widening this out. So that's what will probably happen. I'll probably pop some really pretty color right in front of them. They're great in any areas where you struggle. So any really hot, sunny areas where the soil's bad, these will do it. These love it. They're super adaptable to all different kinds of soil other than wet soil. They don't want to be anywhere where it doesn't drain. Also really great for containers because they're a gorgeous plant even before they start to bloom. They're just a beautiful kind of succulent looking plant. So if you want to have some low maintenance containers, this is a great option. So the next one is a proud berry coral berry. I've actually noticed quite a few guys asking how this particular shrub has been doing. I've really loved it. In fact, around it, I have daylilies and spiderwort planted, but they were looking really mangy. So I just cleaned up this area and threw a little mulch down not long ago. And it actually makes the shrub kind of stand out, and so you can see it a little bit better. It hasn't put on a ton of growth this year, but we planted it so late in the fall that this is technically its first growing season. Because when you plant in the fall, you know, it can kind of sit there and maybe root in a little bit, but it doesn't really put on much growth. It has filled in though. I think it's a lot more full than it was last year. And it is recommended when these start to put on growth in the spring. So when you start to see new green growth, it's recommended to come in and cut it down to about 12 inches, the whole thing, because it blooms and fruits on new wood. And that way you get a fresh new stand every single year. I did not do that this year because I had a baby instead. So I wasn't really thinking about like individual shrub maintenance at that point of the year. But this has done well anyway, which makes me very happy. The berries are beautiful. Now you might notice that the leaves have a little bit of white on them, and it's because we have a little bit of overspray from our lawn sprinklers, because this only sits about, oh, maybe 2 feet back from our grass. So and our water is very, very hard. So it gets a little drift and it is forming a little bit on the leaves, which this is something we are going to be working on. We're working on our water system every single year to where we can get all of our plants away from any overhead sprinkling, get everything on drip. In fact, this bed has two rows of drip tubing running right down it. So this is kind of right in the middle of two brown drip tubes. So it gets plenty of water. I haven't had to supplement it at all. And I didn't put any individual emitters, like I didn't run any extra water to it. And it's doing great that way. So this is a zone 3 through 7, extremely winter hardy. Wildlife like the berries, they actually hold on quite a bit through the winter. So it's very pretty to look at. I mean, it's considered a winter interest shrub. And it grows about 3 to 4 feet tall and wide. So I'm expecting it just to kind of fill in this area. We have kind of a yellow rose right to its right. And then right here, I'm actually planting something different. I planted a vertigo pinnacetum with some silver bullet artemisia, supertunia black cherry, just to bring in a little bit of interest. But I am planning on doing a tree arch right here, which is a whole different video, and then I'll be filling in with some other things. But I'm just really happy with how this one has done, and I do plan on probably coming in and cutting some of these branches for some fall arranging. All right, let's head to our last shrub. So this right here is a Miss Violet butterfly bush, and it has grown so much this year. We didn't do an actual spotlight video on this one. It was part of our butterfly bush care tip guide. I was giving tips on how to properly plant them, and this is the one we put in the ground, and it was only about 2 feet tall when we planted it. So it has grown so much and it's filled in. I couldn't be happier with this plant right here. And I love the fact that you can kind of look through the fence and you can see the fountain and the boxwood hedge. And then these right here, now these are an oriental lily. I don't know what variety they are, but they bloom yellow and they're done for the year. I'm about ready to come in and clean them up. But you can imagine what they look like when there was the yellow blooms with the purple right behind it. It was just such a gorgeous blend. So the Miss series and the Lo and Behold series are both sterile varieties of butterfly bush. And it's kind of an interesting thing. Here in Oregon, the traditional butterfly bushes are like against the rules for us. We can't plant them because they're termed a noxious weed, because on the western side of the state, they just pop up everywhere. They don't here in eastern Oregon, but we're kind of lumped into the whole rules of the state there. So we have to plant either butterfly bushes out of the Miss series or the Lo and Behold series. So I don't have to worry about coming in and deadheading mine, because when these fall on the ground, they're not going to produce new plants everywhere, which is so nice, because you can imagine the maintenance that you would have to do if you wanted a really clean looking shrub. But I think it actually looks good to have kind of the spent blooms. It looks, they maintain color pretty well, even when they're dry. And so I think it makes it look really full. This has started blooming about the first part of July, and it'll bloom all the way through frost. There are new blooms coming up all over the place. I mean, I can just point to a whole bunch of new blooms coming up, which I love. I love long blooming things. This attracts pollinators. It's resistant to deer. So these are a zone 5 through 9. And the thing about these, a lot of people say that they suffer some winter dieback. And I think the biggest problem is too much moisture. They like a kind of dry, well-draining soil, a really great pair for your sedums, actually. If you have a spot that's dry and hot, plant butterfly bushes and sedums, and you'll have a very happy garden. When I planted this, I went over the fact that they actually like to be bumped up. The whole root ball, you kind of want to go against all the rules of planting that you've ever been taught, and you want to plant that root ball up above your normal soil level so that it kind of creates a hill for the water to run off and away from the root ball, because most of the time your winter dieback is because it's been sitting in too much water. So really, as long as you kind of know that and kind of follow those guidelines, you'll have a very, very happy plant. Now this one wants to grow about 4 to 5 feet tall and wide, which is perfect for this location. I wanted it to fill in, and I wanted it to go outside of the fence. So we've got kind of a gravel area that's sort of part of our driveway. We don't drive on this part, so it's okay that the shrub kind of goes out, but I wanted it to kind of soften the outside of the fence over here. And it actually looks really pretty. We should walk around there so you guys can see what it looks like. See what it's done right here? It's already coming out a little bit, as well as the arborvitae, and I've got roses and things down that way, and a black lace elderberry. I just wanted this whole side of the fence to still look like it's part of the garden and not like there's nothing, like it's too sterile or something. And that, you know, white fencing can kind of do that sometimes. So I really like how this is growing. It's doing really well. So as far as pruning goes, these bloom on new wood. So you want to go in after they've started to push growth and trim them back a little bit, cut out any dead wood that they may have. But be patient, because butterfly bushes are one of the last things in your garden that will break dormancy, and you'll think they're dead, and you'll be getting into April thinking, should I pull that plant out? I think it's dead. they are still alive. Just give them some time. And then once they start showing that green, cut them back a little bit and then they'll start flushing and look beautiful. So for fertilizer on a shrub like this, and actually the coral berry as well, woody shrubs, I would use rose tone. It's a really good one. I use that in early spring. Typically I'll go around and treat everything that needs it. The sedum I showed you earlier, don't ever fertilize that one or else it will be unhappy. And then you can repeat fertilizer later on in the year. I typically, sometimes I do and sometimes I don't, but usually it's like late summer when I go through for my second round of fertilizer. So that's it, you guys. That is how these plants have done. I'm really happy with all three of them. I think they're all really great shrubs. They've all lasted through one winter here and through one summer. So they've kind of been through the gambit. Plants that grow in Eastern Oregon have to be able to withstand down to negative 20 and then up to about 115 degrees. So, I mean, plants that grow here have to be so, so tough and so adaptable. So I always feel good when I recommend something because, like, if it grows here, it will probably grow for you. So anyway, thank you guys so much for watching this video, and we will see you in the next one. Bye.